going to talk today about this title is ever changing. Today it's cryptography and computing, past, present, and future. All right, so I'm going to talk about cryptography and computing and the interplay between them. And in this vein, sort of, it's actually interesting to notice that even historically speaking, two of the figures, which are kind of the father figures of the computer science, Shannon and Turing, have actually a history which is connected to cryptography. So if you think about Shannon, there are these two very famous papers that he wrote, 1948 and apparently 1945. One of them was a mathematical theory of communication where he introduces information theory, and the other one was a paper called A Communication Theory of Secrecy System, where he actually defines what does it mean for a cryptographic system or encryption method to be perfectly secret. So the definition of secrecy and the definition of information, in Shannon's mind at least, the way that he actually spoke of afterwards, were very much linked. And I think the things were published far apart because one of the papers was classified. So, and then there's Turing, who we think of him as the father of the universal, the inventor of the universal computing machine, and sort of the father of computation devices as we think of them today. And the public probably knows him from the movie where they describe him as a man who broke the German Enigma machine. So again, two people who in our mind are sort of really defining the most fundamental cornerstones, like what is information, how do we capture a general computation, and yet had a big interest in cryptography and possibly has affected their way of defining computation and how they thought of computation. So the other thing that's in common between these two guys is that they actually were motivated by World War II and fighting the German war machine. So their research on cryptography was very much motivated by wartime. And in fact, I think they met during the war in Princeton, that's what the claim is. So here's the switch that we make to the topic today. So I'm talking about modern cryptography as it's been developed in the last 40 years or so. And the one first distinction is it's not just about fighting the bad guys. Okay, with the bad guys, meaning we're going from wartime to applications that have to do with economics and commerce. So in fact, modern cryptography, this original paper by Diffie and Hellman, I think they got the Turing Award this year for it, is they're predicting the fact that with the rise of internet, with the rise of connectivity, and this is at the time in 1976, there's going to be an incredible potential here for commerce, for people to do not just to communicate with each other, but to actually have a whole world of economic of commerce on the internet. And this is a prediction which today we don't even think about it, right? It's, you know, you buy on eBay, you buy on Amazon, that's what we all do. We have transactions in banks. So it is a very, you know, they had incredible foresight, but they've also launched here the beginning of what we call modern cryptography. How to enable this secure commerce among, you know, millions and millions of people without having to meet with each other ahead of time, but somehow still be able to communicate privately with some sort of trust that they're communicating with the right people and securely. Okay, so modern cryptography is not sort of takes a departure from the whole wartime to commerce application. And in the future, and in fact, not just the future, but in the last probably 30 years, the transition is another transition, and that is instead of just talking about talking about privacy and authenticity of communication, as were the previous applications, it focuses now on correctness and privacy of computation. So we're sort of going from communication, just from the fact that we're communicating with each other, to computation. And in the future in particular, I believe that this ability to ensure that computation, even if it's not done in the privacy of your home, is done correctly and can preserve the privacy of your data, even if it's not doesn't reside at home, using cryptographic technique. And that's going to enable us to essentially use all these remote computing servers and the excessive amounts of large data that everybody talks about that are available to us with maintaining our basic right to be left alone. So what is this basic right to be left alone? So that's a famous quote from early paper of Judge Brandeis and others, where I think the paper's like the turn of the century, This is around the time that cameras weren't used anymore in a camera shop. You didn't have to go to a shop to get a photograph, but people could take pictures anywhere. And he said, oh my God, they're going to be taking pictures. What about privacy? What about our right to be left alone? So obviously we're in a very different place today. But what I hope to convince you is that with what we know to do in cryptography today, possibly we can do what we want to do and still be left alone. Okay? So that's what I'm trying, my talk will be about. So one thing is just one slide. I want to say that this paper of Diffie-Hellman is around 76, and since then there's been a lot of really incredible abilities, I believe, in somewhat paradoxical in nature, that cryptography enabled. But I only have an hour, I think I only 50 minutes even, and now even less, in any case. So I just want to kind of put it out there, okay? There's a bunch of things that we know how to do. I'll say maybe a word on each, and then I'll try to tell you what's in common among them and focus on a few of them. So starting from this paper that you all know, I'm sure, by RSA, Rebeshamir Nadelman, there's this ability that we can meet. We don't have to meet, and we still can exchange messages in privacy. We can sign contracts, even though we're not in the same place. So contracts, the important thing is I don't want to sign it unless you sign it. So we need some sort of illusion of simultaneity, even though we are not in the same place. So we can get this effect of simultaneity using cryptographic ideas. We can verify proofs, let's say proofs of identity, if you're trying to prove that you are who you are, without giving any information, except the fact that you believe proof. And this is a general ability, which we call zero knowledge verification of proofs, and I'll talk a bit more about that during the talk. We can play games on the computer, so there could be many parties, and they want to play, let's say, a poker game, without a deck, and without a referee, a trusted referee, and still we're going to believe that the rules of the games were obeyed and nobody's cheating. We can do this for general games. We can access databases that hold information without the database knowing which information we're after, which is very relevant, let's say, if you want to do a patent search and you don't want people to see what you're looking at, and many other applications. We can compute on encrypted data, which is another thing I'll speak of today, which is a very important ability. We can do many other things. Maybe one more that I'll mention is a very exciting new area of research where the question is still up, or the jury is out, whether we can or cannot execute encrypted programs. So here the idea is, say you have a program and you want to give it to someone else so they'll be able to run it, that is run, give inputs, get outputs as much as they like, but you don't want to find out anything about what algorithm the program uses. So we can think of this program as an encrypted program, which still can be executed. Sometimes that's called program obfuscation. So this is sort of one of the hot topics of cryptography today. There are many candidates, many of them are broken. It's kind of one of these questions which is still up in the air. So here's a list. The list is sort of like a laundry list. You can encrypt, you can sign contracts, you can prove in zero knowledge, you can play games, you can run executed programs. The reason I put this up there is, first of all, I think it is kind of fantastic. And but the second reason is to illustrate that it's not really clear how you define what cryptography is. Okay. So is it a bunch of people working on this similar, you know, a community that has a similar taste? What is it? So the thing that's in common among all this list, and if I had to define what the field is about, it's the unifying theme is that there's an adversary present. So this guy is the adversary. So what do I mean by that? I mean that I always give this analogy that in most computer science department, people have taken algorithms classes, and in an algorithms class, they talk about analysis of algorithms, right? You want to analyze the algorithm ran in a certain amount of time. And often people say, well, even for the worst case input, an input chosen by an adversary, we can show that the algorithm will run quickly. So there is a notion of an adversarially chosen input. But for cryptography, it's not just that. It's more that the whole problem, it's an integral part of the definition of the problem to have an adversary. So if I want to communicate with someone and I'm worried about secrecy, it only makes sense if somebody's trying to listen. Or if I'm trying to sign a contract with someone, why don't I just sign and then let them sign it? It's because I don't trust them. Because in a sense, the person I'm signing with is the adversary. So any cryptographic problem, the one thing you could be assured of is that there is an adversary, he's part of the problem, and in fact, who that adversary is will determine the quality of what we accept as a solution. So in other words, it's a very strong adversary, we have to work harder. It's a very weak adversary, it might be easy to solve. The adversary may have different inputs, it may have different computational power, but it's very important to realize it exists, or she, and what their power is. In fact, that's once you design a system and you prove that it works, in whatever manner it works means it for your application, with respect to the adversary, it's very it's a good way, I think, to approach any kind of complex system. You have no idea what the failure will be, so we have an adversary, and in the presence of this worst case adversary, we'd like to prove that our solution works. So who is the adversary in cryptographic world? So the adversary, essentially, we don't want to make any assumption on the strategy. He's going to be worst case, so he's not just someone who tosses coins and makes sort of injects random errors into the system. He really is worst case, trying to sabotage the system. But, and that's the most important part in this slide, we're going to assume that this adversary is computationally bounded. Now, that's not given that that's the right assumption, but it is the assumption that we make. So in other words, this adversary who's going to fight encryption, who might fight authentication or trying to sabotage computation, he's very smart, he's very evil, he's worst case. However, he only has a bounded amount of time in his disposal. So what's a bounded amount of time? So in the world of threat computer science, we mean we capture that as polynomial time. So there is some sort of parameter that the whole system that describe it, let's say, we often call it a security parameter, let's say size k, he cannot run 2 to the k, cannot run exponential computations. But he can run computations which look like, k squared, k cubed, k to the 100 polynomial time computations. Now, why do we make this assumption on our adversary? First of all, we believe it's realistic. So if this k goes up, the adversary's power goes up, but not in a way that's unreasonable. So, and second of all, once we say that the adversary is bounded this way, we can do all these applications that I had on the first page, where we don't have to meet, can still sign contracts, can play games, and so forth. Whereas some of these applications you can prove are impossible if the adversary had exponential time. Are we good? Or maybe I'm saying things that everybody knows, but I'm just setting the stage. Good. So we have an adversary throughout, and the adversary is computationally bounded, even though every once in a while we can show that even when he's unbounded, something is possible. So let me give you a few, let me be a little more concrete. So what does it mean that it's bounded? Okay, so what it means really when it translates to what you look at, if you look at the research, it means that there are certain problems which we believe are too hard for the adversary to solve. So what are some of these problems? Factoring integers is a famous problem that people have thought of as computationally difficult. Then there are these quantum algorithms for it, so we say it's difficult for classical algorithms. It's an assumption. Okay, the kind of problem that people use more today, rather than factoring, in most of the research that I'll speak about later, is this problem called learning with errors. The idea is this: there's a set of equations, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, a bunch of equations. These are equations in these variables, S1, S2, S3, S4. So there is S, it signifies a secret. It's a string of bits, and it's unknown. And what the adversary can see throughout whatever cryptographic application we set up is a set of equations in S. So for the first minute, you should think, wait a second, if I see the solution to a bunch of equations, and I know also what the equations are, then I can do Gaussian elimination and find S. So that's actually not that hard. So not quite. So what we give the adversary is a set of equations, solutions to the equations, we don't give them the S's, but then we put noise into the equations. So we don't actually give them the right solution, but we make it a little dirty. So we add some noise to it. So we get the solution to a bunch of noisy equations, and the adversary's task is to find the secret S. And this turns out to be, a problem which the best algorithm for is exponential. I think it's time 2 to the n. And that's even true by quantum algorithms. So sometimes we call this post-quantum, because we don't know how to solve it even with quantum algorithms. It's also as hard as some classical problems. I won't get into it. It's very easy to work with. So most of the cryptographic schemes you hear about today that people are inventing that have great facility to do more than conventional encryption are related sometimes directly to the difficulty of solving such problems. So in other words, the adversary, we assume, with all his ingenuity, with all his worst case intention, does not have enough computational power. in order to solve this problem. Questions? Okay, so we know what the adversary is. Yeah? Good. What can the two other things that I want to say before I get into concrete cryptography is sort of how cryptographers think, or at least how I think they think, which means is how I think. All right, so we have sort of two axiomatic ways, that, definitions that we use. One is what we call computationally indistinguishability. What does that mean? It's a big word, but what does it mean? It means that we often see in cryptographic works the following game. The game is this. On one hand, there's the adversary, this computationally bounded adversary. And on the other hand, there's, in some sense, a wall, and two distributions are sitting there. One, let's just think about these are k-bit strings, distribution on k-bit strings, another distribution, they're different. Okay, so this might be uniform, all k-bit strings can come up, this might be very different. Maybe a subset, maybe everything can come up with very different probabilities. And the adversary, his goal in the world, and we'll in a minute connect it to real world applications, but his goal in the world is to figure out whether this D1 is behind the screen or D2. Now how can he do it? He's standing behind the screen, because what he's, the ability is he can press a button and get a sample. And each time he gets a sample, from if it's D1, it's D1, 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 or always D2. And he can do this for a normal number of samples, and then he says, you know, I think I have been looking at this distribution or looking at this distribution, okay? And what we'd like is, we say that these two distributions are indistinguishable, you cannot distinguish between them computationally, if after asking for that many samples, he cannot tell better than 50, half plus epsilon. Essentially, if he had to guess, he would be wrong, negligibly better than right, than 50-50 of the time. And this notion, or this way of definition, is extremely useful when you want to define what you want from secure encryption, from pseudorandomness, from simultaneity, and so forth. So let me give you an example. So here's an example of how you put such a definition in place when you want to talk about secure encryption. So when we're talking about secure encryption, we have some encryption algorithm, right? And what would we like from it? So obviously we don't want the message to be revealed, but there might be a lot more that we want. And here's how you could capture that. So an ultimate encryption, we would say, is such that no matter which two messages you might be encrypting, so two different messages, his goal in the world, of course, is to know which one. You'll say that this encryption is essentially computationally indistinguishable for the adversary if you encrypt it, on one hand, you look at the encryptions of M0. Let's think about it, that it's not a single encryption, but there's lots of ways to encrypt M0. And on the other hand, you look at encryptions of M1, okay? So these are two different sets. They just don't have the same, there's nothing in the intersection. But he doesn't know which one is present. He keeps on pressing the sample. Every time he presses, he gets a different encryption of M0, or a different, or all of them are encryptions of M1. If we say that he cannot tell better than 50-50, essentially, whether he's looking at encryption of M0 or M1, we're saying this is a fantastic encryption scheme. In fact, you can show that if this is the case, this encryption scheme will hide all partial information about the message. There's nothing you can tell about the message. If it's the significant bit is 0 or 1, if it's the exclusive order of the bits or 0 or 1, anything. So the message is really fully opaquely hidden. Good? So here's kind of natural to see what would be these two distributions. Let's say that you wanted to talk about pseudorandom number generation and talk about a good pseudorandom number generator. Then what would be the distributions? One of them might be the set of random numbers, really uniform, all numbers can come up with equal probability, and the other, the set of pseudorandom numbers that were generated by the pseudorandom program, by the pseudorandom number generator. And to say that it's a good pseudorandom number generator would mean that you won't be able to distinguish whether you're looking at truly random numbers or numbers generated by a deterministic program. And whichever application you want to talk about, you can sort of fairly naturally define what are these distributions, and then use this notion and see if you can achieve it. And in fact, it turns out you can achieve encryption schemes of this sort. The crux of the matter for that is that, for example, for encryption, the crux of the matter is how to encrypt a single bit. So we're not encrypting long messages. Suppose I just know that I'm either looking at the encryption of 0 or encryption of 1. I want to tell which is which. Is it 0 or is it 1? So the crux of how to solve it is you want to find some sort of decision problem which is hard on the average, okay? So it's a 0-1 problem. It's hard to tell, given a random instance, it's hard to tell it better than 50-50. So this is a half plus, actually negligible, okay? And so we can't do better than a half plus, let's say 1/2 to the k. And, but it's easy to generate random yes or no instances. So if you had something like this, then you could encrypt single bits. Why? If you wanted to encrypt a zero, you would generate a random yes instance. If you wanted to encrypt a one, you would generate a random no instance. And an adversary cannot tell apart whether you're talking about yes or no, because it's hard to distinguish. There you have a way to send a single bit encryption. So, we have a note, we have who is the adversary? One of our axiomatic definitions, which is we want to talk about the indistinguishability of probability distributions. Okay. One more example of what the adversary might want to do has to do with this program obfuscation that I mentioned in the beginning. So remember I said that one of the tasks that today cryptography is grappling with? מתגוששים, מתמודדים. Is whether you can come up with programs which you can give someone to execute, but they find out nothing about the program except for the input-output behavior. So what's a way to define that? What is it you want from the program? What I just said is not a definition. I mean, at least if it's a definition, it's a hard one to deal with. So here's a definition people have used. They said, well, we will say that if you, you write a paper, you say, here's a way to obfuscate programs. The way that what I expect from you to prove is the following. So let's look at two programs, P1 and P2, P0 and P1. So these are two pieces of code. And let's say that these programs are for the same problem. So same input, they get the same output. So they're functionally equivalent. And now let's apply whatever obfuscation method we have to the program 1 and whatever obfuscation we have to program 0. Again, these methods are going to be probabilistic. So once you apply obfuscation, there's going to be lots of different programs that result here, lots of different programs that result here. And you're going to say that this is a good obfuscation method if an adversary can't tell when he is given a program, and now he can run it, whether he's actually working with an obfuscation of program 0 or obfuscation of program 1. So again, it's this indistinguishability. And he cannot tell better than 50-50. So even though now he gets the code, he can run it many times, what is that giving him? It's giving him input-output behavior. Both of these programs have the same input-output behavior. But you wanted to say that beyond that, you cannot distinguish whether you're working. You got an obfuscation of program 1 or program 0. So I'm saying that this definition is also in place today as applied to program obfuscation. It's just that we don't know how to solve this problem. So encryption, sort of randomness, and so forth, we know how to do. At least it's as hard as the problem that I gave you with the equations or integer factoring. Here we're still, the question is, jury's out. Okay, one more thing to say before we get into particulars. In what I define in that game between the adversary and the screen and the two distributions, the adversary was on the outside. You were on the inside. You meaning the encryptor, generating encryption, generating pseudorandomness, executing programs. Often in cryptography, what makes it complicated is the adversary is actually part of the system. So in the example of signing contracts, I was signing contracts with you, you're part of the whole problem. You are the adversary, and yet I have to sign contracts with you. So there we say, so it's not that you're just pressing a button getting a distribution. You yourself are part of the process. So here we have another definition where we will say the fact that this, let's say in this system, there are two people, and they're going through some sort of a protocol back and forth. It could be a signing protocol, it could be something else. We want to say that being an insider gives this adversary no extra abilities, or what we call zero knowledge, if, essentially, even if he wasn't part of the system, okay, and was the one who actually generating, he was helping to generate this real view. By real view, I mean V1, P1, V2, and so forth, the transcript here. He could have generated such a fake transcript or simulated transcript at home. So just at home, without me, and he's trying to learn something about me, he could have simulated interactions or views which are indistinguishable, which look essentially the same as what he would have gotten when he's interacting with me. So one question that comes up here is, so why is he talking to me? It's a little confusing. Why doesn't he just sit at home and simulate the whole world? Because there's an objective, of course, when, let's say, we're signing contracts or something. So there's some input, I want to get some output, okay? So what the definition says is, given the output, okay, on your input, given an output for free, the extra stuff that goes on in the conversation, he couldn't have simulated on his own. Anyway, it's somewhat of a technical definition, but it's an important one because it gives us sort of a benchmark of how to define security protocols. It essentially says that the protocol is secure if we could have simulated it on our own, in addition to sort of the input output that you benefit. And that allows to compose secure protocols and many other things. All right, so let's make progress now. So the world of computing has changed quite a bit since I started, and probably since most of you started. So it used to be, you know, we had these big computers at home, floppy disks, all kinds of secure storage devices in the sense that they were in my room, you know. In fact, in my room, they're very secure because I can't even find them. And you know, the cloud was a real cloud, but things have changed. And in a sense, you know, we're talking about remote computing, about cloud computing, and computers have gotten smaller and smaller. And the image for the future, right, is that we're going to have a very small handheld device. It's not even that futuristic. And most of what I'm doing is searching or computing, but not on my device elsewhere. So what that means is our data is migrating, right, to the cloud, Dropbox, whatever. And the data could be pictures, could be files, could be genetic information. But all of that is not really sitting locally, but often is sitting somewhere else. And the second thing that's happening here is that even though that's not, I don't know how much of that, in a sense, is done today, for the future, we're saying also computation will be done elsewhere. So not only data, but also the real computing will be done elsewhere. And maybe the worst part is that there's a collection of data about us. So whether we drive, or we Facebook, or we look at movies, or we're interested in shopping, all of that is being recorded by other parties. So whereas in the previous two pictures, I put my data in the cloud, or I decided to compute in the cloud, there's a lot of information about me that's being stored elsewhere. And this can be quite sensitive, medical, financial, surveillance, and so forth. Okay, so this is the reality of computing today. And we all know that there's really enormous benefit. I mean, there's really an enormous potential benefit in the fact that there is all this data out there being aggregated. Why is there benefit? Because it enables us to do many things today, such as in health, you know, sharing data sets for research, disease control, national security, threat prediction, and law enforcement, and more mundane things like data analytics, right? We can reroute traffic, we can use energy in a smart way. There's economic growth because you know how to target consumers. You can risk predictions. You can predict risks for financial markets. It's obviously good to have information to improve life, and there's no question about that. But, I just want to say that maybe if we have to focus on one application, we can think about genomics. So people get sequenced more and more, and so the data is really growing exponentially, and researchers share data sets for disease risk modeling, and people are talking about actionable precision medicine coming soon, right? So there's going to be all this information, and they can sort of target medicine to you, to your problems, to your DNA. A lot of people stand to benefit, you know, patients, insurers, providers, employers, and so forth. So all they stand to gain enormous benefit from the fact that we understand better the genomic information. But, and that will be very evident in a moment, I claim that there is enormous potential risk also in this globalization of information. So the fact that people, that there's a lot of this collection of information about us, obviously there's a lot to gain, but there is also a lot to lose. And what are some examples which we are going to address with our cryptographic machinery very soon? One is loss of control. So who's controlling your data now? Someone else. And that's, you know, means that there's threat to whether data that you get back is authentic and the correctness of the computation on that data. There's loss of privacy, both for data and for programs. There's loss of fairness. So people, based on the data they know about you, they may profile you, and depending on your profile, allow you certain jobs, give you certain prices, and there's also liability of knowledge. So those data holders, people are holding data about you, they are, if you think about it from their point of view, they're also liable for lawsuits and so forth because they have the information, whether they acted upon it or not, they do hold it. So these are a bunch of risks. These are probably second tier in my mind, even though with respect to sort of, you know, the real world, maybe that's why anybody would be interested in privacy from a point of view of a corporation. But from my point of view, you know, the fact that my data is elsewhere, the fact that all control over my computation is elsewhere provides an enormous risk. And I just want to say that it's not that futuristic. So if we go back to the genomic application, there has been cases already around the world where, you know, in the context of life insurance, it's a problem if somebody gets a hold of your genetic information. There's some famous case here where they, some DNA test revealed some risk for a child who was expelled from school because of that, and some other examples. So the reason I'm kind of thinking that the genomic example is the best example, because often people talk about methods such as anonymization. So they're saying, well, what's the problem? Take the data and remove your name from it, or remove your zip code from it, or remove any identifying information. You know, this is, let's say, if we want to analyze energy usage or analyze road, people driving on roads and things like that. But these methods don't work. And the place where it's really very obvious they don't work is really when you think about genomic data. So even if you take somebody's genomic data and you strip their name and social security and zip code from it, it's revealing in itself. And this is really grounds for all these cases that you've seen before. So in other words, just from looking at somebody's data, that's telling a lot of information about who they may be and who their family may be, and things about them they don't know themselves, like risk disease going down the line and so forth. Okay, so here we are. Got all this data out there. And if I gave this talk 3 years ago, that would be very exciting, but you all know that. So there's all this data out there, and it provides fantastic opportunities, lots of risk. And the question is, can we do anything about it? Okay, so that really is the main question. And that is the question here. Can math and technology and cryptography enable advancement without complete relinquishment of individual control? That's really the big question. We've got all these benefits, we don't want to give them up. Nobody's going to say, let's not study certain diseases because we worry about privacy. It's not realistic, maybe it's not even right. Okay? The question is, what can you do? Is there any chance that we can do all that and not relinquish control and privacy? And the answer for the rest of the talk is yes, in my opinion. Because currently, all the methods that are being used reveal way more data than necessary to extract the benefits and relinquish too much control. So that there are ways to achieve the goals, to achieve the benefits without the risks, at least to a large extent. All right. So essentially, the rest of the talk is really what the talk is about, which is a little bit, give you a little bit of magic of advanced cryptography. And there are going to be sort of three nuggets that I'll touch on. One is that we can verify computation without actually doing it. So the fact that some other remote computer is doing computation for us should not mean that we have no idea whether they performed it correctly or not, because we can verify the outcome of the computation. Two is that we can actually perform computation on data without looking at the data. Another bizarre statement on its own. So in other words, I don't have to actually give my data away and compromise all my privacy. I aggregate computation on lots of data, on single bits of data, can be done without directly looking at it. Third is I can allow people to extract approval partial information on encrypted data and nothing else. So I can give maybe a remote server a lot of encrypted data and ask them and allow them to encrypt some partial information from it, but not the entire message. So these are sort of three abilities which we can do, and I think that they go a long way to be able to do the benefits without risks. Okay, any questions? Because it's been very monotonous. Any questions? Uncomfortable, you can move in your seat, no? Oh, good, a question, what? Where do you say good?
No, you say without risks or something like the Apple issue, breaking into the Apple
Right, no, no, so I agree with you. In fact, that's when I said benefits and risks, so in that example, I would say it's a benefit to gain access. The risk here is that you could gain access to a lot of other people's phones. So in that particular example, there is a benefit. Let's say that we agree that it's a benefit to break into this phone and find out some, let's say, some information, contact information or whatever. And the risk is that the method is so weak that you can break into every phone. So there is risk and benefit there. I mean, we're talking very kind of loosely. I'm not putting any moral judgment about good or bad. When I say benefit, I mean you could put that as a benefit, you could put whatever benefit you like. When I say risk is, in some sense, going one step beyond what you need to achieve in terms of release of information or relaxation of correctness and so forth. So in a sense, you define what you want, okay? What I'd like in an ideal world is it's exactly what you get. So you could sort of say, I want to know the contact list on that phone and I've gotten the rights because the court order or national security order, that's what you get. Nothing else. You don't have gained access to anything else on the phone or the probe or the secrets that enables privacy of these phones. And in fact, you know, well, we won't go there, but some of the tools we have would enable even defining what that means. So how would we know now if somebody provides a solution, you said, yes, in this solution you only find the contacts and nothing else. How do we know that? So one way you could use this definition of zero knowledge or is simulation. If they could simulate everything that they got on their own anyway, besides the contact information, that's one way to define a successful solution that only delivered the contact information. Okay, great question. Okay, so what do I want to tell you about now? So I want to give you a little bit about each of these three. And I'll start with this. How do you verify computation without doing the computation? Okay? And somehow, all of a sudden, I'm going to take a tour elsewhere. Okay? So I've done this already twice in the talk. I'm going to talk now about this question of verifying proofs. Okay? And we'll talk about verifying proofs, which seems like a totally mathematical abstraction, and then we'll bring us back to verifying computation. So proofs. So we've got all these provers up here, and you know, Pythagoras theorem or whatever, different proofs, and classical proofs, we know what they look like, at least in the US, when you have math classes, that's what they look like. There's one column of axioms, another column of claims that follow from the axioms, and so forth. So proofs are, you know, something you can write down in a book, step by step, check line by line, and at the end, QED, it's been proved. Now, usually when we think about proofs, and we will connect it back to cryptography and computation, because I am known to open a lot of parentheses, but then I close them. I mean, today may be different, but usually. So in any case, proofs, we're so in love with provers, you know, sort of this is the culture of mathematics, that we are so admiring of provers that we kind of forget that there's actually somebody else, and that is whoever has to read the proof, okay? So actually a proof consists of two parties. There's a prover, it's hardworking, and we all bow to them, and then there is the verifier, and that is the person or the entity that actually verifies the correctness of the proof. So we can really think of a proof as a process where there's something to be proved, the claim, and then you write down the proof, send it over to the verifier, think of reading it in a book, and they take, in our framework, polynomial time, so they shouldn't take exponential time to verify the proof, but they take a bounded, reasonable amount of time to verify the proof is correct. Okay? So what's an example of a claim and a proof? Could be there's some equation, it's really hard to solve, she knows how to solve it, she found the solution, and she sent it over to the verifier, and he, you know, is not very bright, but he can plug in the values, and if it agrees, the equation is satisfied, he accepts. Okay? You think of these as 0, 1, if you like, in general, some sort of Boolean equation. It's not a great example for it. Okay, so this is a let's think of every proof, something like that. It's a system of equations. Somebody has to satisfy them, they find the solution, they give it to us, we check. Now the thing about this method is after the interaction, okay, after she sends him x1 through xn, he now believes the solution is solvable, assuming she got the correct solution, a correct solution, But he also knows a particular solution. So he knows X1 for X. He didn't do the work to find them, but he actually now received them. So one of the questions that is going to be a key question behind this whole topic that I'm going to get to, which is how do you verify a computation without doing it, is there any other way, is there any other way for the verifier to check, you know, that this equation is solvable? Or is it the case that no matter how we think of it, it's always going to be the case that after he receives this solution, he knows the equation is solvable, but he has, and he has a solution in his hands. And it turns out that there is another way. And the crux of it is that instead of actually giving him the solution, she proves to him that she could prove. So she says, I could give you the solution if I felt like it. Now, she's not, but I'm not going to do it. So, so what does that mean? It means that if she could do it, then I know it's doable, then the equation is solvable. So this is as good as giving directly the solution. But the way that she's going to do that is going to require some to deviate from this textbook idea of a proof, where you just write down the proof, send it over. It's going to require randomness, so it's going to be some coins being tossed during the process of verifying the proof is correct, and there's going to be some interaction. So somehow, there is already interaction, right? The prover is sending something to the verifier, but there's going to be non-trivial interaction. There's going to be some more going back and forth, okay? And I'm going to give you an example of that, which some of you have seen. Who has not seen it? No, who has seen it? So by elimination, there's some people who have not seen it. I'm giving it anyway. Okay, so let's look at a particular kind of equation. This is a sort of the simplest example you can give, and I'm going to simplify it even further. So an example here is of a single equation. What she wants to prove to him is that she, on a given y, that there is a solution to this quadratic equation, that y is equal to x squared, and then there's this mod n there. Forget it, if you don't know what that is, it doesn't really matter. Just think about it as y equal to x squared. Obviously, to prove to someone that there is a solution to y equal to x squared, that's easy. Because at least when I went to school, we learned how to take square roots. I don't think they do that anymore. That is an easy computation. But once you add this mod n, it turns out that if n is a large number that's hard to factor, this is very difficult. This is the hardest factoring integers. So this is a hard equation to solve. But she's all-powerful. She's a prover. She knows how to solve these equations. Maybe she knows a secret that enables her to do it, whatever. What she's trying to convince the verifier is that, in fact, this equation is solved. She wants to do it without just giving x to him. Because she just gave him x, no problem. He takes x, squares it, well, checks if it's equal to y mod n. But instead, we want to do it in a different way. So that at the end, he will believe that, well, that the solution is equation is solvable, but he doesn't know what x is. So let's just remind ourselves to those who know, or learn, those who don't know, what's the idea here, okay? So the idea is the following. What she does is she chooses some random r that has nothing to do with the y that she's trying to convince it solve. Has a solution quadratic equation. And what she sends over, there's a conversation here, what she sends over to the prover, the guy, who is trying to check whether this claim is true, she says to him, listen, let's think of two equations, okay? One equation is z, and she says, I'm claiming that z is equal to r squared mod n. She knows it is, because she took z and made it equal to r squared mod n. And another equation, she says, she takes this z, which she just created, multiplies it by y, z times y, okay? And she claims to him, you know, both of these equations, z and zy, they both have solutions, quadratic solutions. That's the claim, all right? So she gives, and she says, I claim both of these equations are solvable, but I'm not going to solve both of them for you. Because if I did, namely, I gave you r and I gave you rx, you would be able to figure out what x is, just divide rx by r, and then know that the original one is solved. So I'm not giving you the solution to both. I'm claiming both are solvable, and I'm letting you have the opportunity, okay? You can decide whether you want to see a solution to equation one or equation two. You tell me, are you interested to see a solution for one or for two? Okay, but I'm only giving you one. So what does this guy do, this verifier? If I could get him up here. There he is. So he says to himself, oh my God, I guess I know that if she solves both, the original formula is solvable. She's not allowing me to look at both, which should I look at? If I choose this one, maybe this z is equal to r squared, but the original one, nothing. If I choose this one, maybe this is true, but the original one is not. However, she has no idea what I'm going to ask for. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to toss a coin and choose at random whether I want to see a solution to equation one or a solution to equation two. If she can answer either way, regardless of my coin toss, I know that there's a good chance she could have answered both. And therefore, the original formula is solved. So that's exactly what he does. He tosses a coin, flips it to choose whether he wants to see any solution to equation one or equation two. She answers, gives him the solution to the equation he requests. Now, if the original thing is not solvable, okay, then one of these equations is not solvable. What's the chance she asks for the one that's not solvable? At least 50-50, because she just tossed the coin. So there's a good chance, 50-50 chance, that she'll catch him in a mistake if he's trying to cheat. But if he's not cheating and he's saying the truth, he will always be able to supply an answer. So what is the decision of the verifier? Essentially, if she answers correctly, he says, okay, she managed to answer my question, I accept. If she answers incorrectly, obviously he rejects. And what are we saying? We're claiming that if in fact she's not a liar and she's saying the truth, okay, then she can always convince him to accept. If she is a liar, okay, and the claim is false, there is a probability of a half that he can catch the mistake. So in other words, it looks like you might be accepting incorrect claims with probability 50-50. Not great. I mean, I would prefer it was higher. So that's not a problem because they can play this game 100 times. So again, she generates equations. She says choose one or two. He chooses them at random. The chance he catches her is a half. So what's the probability he never catches her? He doesn't catch her the first time, the second time, the third time, the fourth time. Very, very small. So he will catch her with probably 1 minus 1 and 2 to 100. Okay, so what have we done here? We've managed to come up with an alternative way to prove statements so that you can always prove correct statements. There's very, very little probability that you can prove incorrect statements. Okay, and the important part in this whole complicated or semi-complicated interaction is that he never learns what X is. In fact, you can sort of show by the simulation type argument is that he got nothing. He could come up with this random junk that he sees here, okay, on his own. So besides the conviction that she must have known a way to solve this equation, and therefore there is a way to solve the equation, you receive nothing else. All right. So this is actually something called a zero-knowledge interactive proof, which is a mechanism, it's more general than just for that equation, that says that I can prove claims in this way where we can go questions and answers back and forth, and whenever the claim is true, the verifier will be convinced. When the claim is false, he will reject it with very, very high probability. And thirdly, there is what we call zero knowledge. So you get nothing except the conviction that the claim is true. And we sort of claim that this is ultimately what a proof is supposed to provide. It's supposed to be able to prove correct theorems. You're not supposed to be able to prove incorrect theorem, which here is true with a small probability. There's some small probability you will convince him to accept, but it's made exponentially small. So why is this useful? And this is going to bring us back to the cloud. So originally, it was applied to identity, to protect from identity theft, where, in a sense, you thought about the provers proving that they know some secret, like their password, and this person on the other side could verify they know the password, say, which might be a solution to equation, but they learn nothing else. Later, there were wider consequences where you could show that it's not just that equation, but every theorem can be proved in zero knowledge. More recently, and you'll see in a second why I'm putting it in green, people have applied this concept of zero knowledge to very bizarre, in the sense of far from where we started, applications. One of them is this zero knowledge nuclear disarmament. Anybody heard about this? Some of you probably have. It's an interesting work by Boaz Barak and a bunch of physicists in Princeton, which have talked about how could you disarm a nuclear weapon when you're not allowed to look at the weapon and look at the technology. So can you get a proof that you are actually disarming a nuclear weapon in zero knowledge? So of course you have to define zero knowledge for these purposes, but the thing is that if you look at the protocol they end up with, besides the fact they're using physical devices and doing measurements, the type of argumentation of why this protocol is zero knowledge is extremely similar to what I just showed you in the equation example. Another place that this was applied to is forensics. Suppose there's a suspect, he's been suspected of doing a crime, and there's some forensic information on the crime. And people, the police tells him, why don't you give me your, I don't know, blood or DNA, whatever, I'll compare it to the forensic information, and if it's not you, I'll let you go. But he says, I don't want to give you my information because I'm planning, I guess, to commit a crime tomorrow. If you have my information, you'll be able to identify me tomorrow. Or in general, he doesn't want to give them his information. How can he prove in zero knowledge that his DNA information does not match the friends, what they found on the crime, but giving nothing else? Okay, so again, there's this idea of zero knowledge. You're able to verify some claim, which might be that some strings are equal, some strings are different, okay, with zero knowledge. And these days, people are talking about zero coin, right, in the context of Bitcoin, how to have show that you have coins, giving zero knowledge, really, in terms of anonymity, in terms of how you join the chain, the blockchain, and so forth. I think you have experts here which are greater than me in this application. Okay, so this zero knowledge had all these applications, but the application that I'm interested in really is different in the cloud setting. So the thing that's more important than the zero knowledge right now is that in that example, what we were able to do is to decouple, sort of checking correctness from knowledge of the proof, right? So we still could check correctness, but we didn't have to know the proof. And that is enables me to ask some new questions about the nature of proof. And in fact, a lot of these type of questions were asked for the last 25 or 35 years. One of the questions has to do with the cloud. That is, how would it be possible for the cloud to perform computation and yet to prove to me without actually having me have to go through the entire computation or even looking at all the intermediate steps of the computation that the computation was performed correctly. So there's also some statement there. I performed the computation and I want to prove to you that I did it correctly and I want to do it in a quick way, in sort of a shortcut way without having to step you throughout the entire computation. So the question is, how do you do it? How can you take this very simplistic example that I just gave with this one equation and, you know, transformed in this fairly simple way and go all the way to the more general question of cloud computing? So another question is what time I have, if I'm going to go to decide where I'm going, but how much time?
Let's say 25 minutes.
25 minutes, okay. All right, then I'm subjecting you to the full torture then. Pleasure. okay, so what are the kind of things you can do once you decouple correctness from the knowledge of the proof? Okay, what are the things you can do now? So we can go complexity theoretic for a few minutes. So those of you taking complexity theory know that we've got the class NP, and you can describe the class NP as those problems which can be solved, essentially where you can describe the problem again as solving an equation, and which problems are in NP? The ones where all you need to check is whether there exists a solution to the equation. Okay? And another way to think of it is that there are short proofs that for NP statements. So what would be, in this context, a proof, it would be the solution to the equation. But there are other classes out there, and one class is co-NP, which is those problems for which there are no solutions. So it's the kind of equations where there are no solutions. Rather than there exists a solution, there's none. So how do you prove, how does a prover prove to the verifier that there exists no solutions? Not clear. Not clear using classical. And similarly, you may talk about counting how many solutions are there in an equation, or showing that for all x1 there exists x2, for all x3, and so forth, with respect to these variables in this equation. So it turns out that you can use classical proofs to prove NP statements. We don't know how to use classical proofs to prove these kind of statements, but these interactions between the prover and the verifier, where in addition to just sending over the proof, you can ask questions and get answers, and the verifier can also toss coins, actually is a much more general way to prove theorems than the classical one. So not only that you can sort of hide things about the proof, but you can prove harder statements. In fact, you can prove statements of this type, Sharp P, space, all of these are possible you can have a proof system where at the end the verifier will be convinced, even the fact that there's no solution to an equation, or that there's an exponential exact number of solutions to the equation, and so forth. So this mechanism of going back and forth is a much more general and more powerful mechanism. And furthermore, it's not the only mechanism out there. You know, now that we've sort of liberated and we don't have to think about proofs as something that's written in a book, we can think of other mechanisms. So here's another mechanism. Rather than one prover, there are two. All of a sudden there was one, he already was strange enough, now there are two. And the thing about the two of them, they're really hard workers. The verifier still doesn't trust them, but he says, you know what, you go into one room, you go into another room, I'm gonna ask some questions from one of you, then I'll go to the other room and interrogate the other one, and if I find an inconsistency in your answers, then I know that you guys don't have the proof. But if I don't find an inconsistency, that convinces me that there is one proof that satisfies all my questions and answers. It's just another paradigm. You know, we had the prover writing in a book, then we had the prover interacting, now we have two provers who have this, I'm able to separate between them and interrogate them separately. It's another way to check whether there's a proof or not. And you can still define here completeness and soundness. So regardless of the fact that they're in separate rooms, they can convince him if the claim is true. And if the claim is false, he will be able to catch an inconsistency. And why do I go here? Because it turns out that once you go to this mechanism, okay, then not only that they can prove very difficult theorems, and not only that they can prove it giving no extra knowledge, okay, but the third thing that's true is that they can prove it using very few bits. So far, if you think about the original interaction that we had with the x squared mod n, yes, it was zero knowledge, but there was a lot of interaction going on. Instead of just sending x, you send two equations, they asked the question, you gave back, so it sort of was longer. So what we are aiming at is getting these proofs that are actually more efficient to check than the original proof mechanism. And when you think about this bizarre two provers sitting in two different rooms, it turns out, using a lot more math, that there's very little, okay, that they need to hear from both from these provers in order to verify claims. Very little in the sense that it's very efficient in terms of number of bits you look at and the kind of computations you do. And this will be key for the cloud setting. Let me give you just a hint of why is it the case that possibly talking to two might be, you have to talk less. Even though you're talking to two of them, you have to speak less or listen less. So here's an example of the kind of claim. So rather than talking about a single equation, let's say that there's a system of equations, okay? There's six equations here. And the goal in the world now of the verifier is to know whether he happens to know that from these equations, either less than 51% are solvable or more than 99%. Well, how did I come up with this? It's essentially an NP-hard problem, okay? So it captures a big class of problems. So he's got this set of equations and he wants to know this. So what's one way to convince him? Just solve 99% of the equations, right? At least to convince him that more than 99% are solved. You just solve 99%. But then you have, for every equation, give a solution. What's another way to do it? Here's another way to do it, when you have two provers, okay? Which will require them to only send him three bits. Rather than solving 99% of the equation, they can give him three bits of information, and he would be as satisfied, or almost as satisfied. So here's what he does. He first of all, chooses a random equation. So among the six, he chooses one, let's say he chose that one. He takes this equation, okay, and he points to, let's say, prover one, and he says, hey, give me a an assignment to x1, x4, and x7 that satisfies this solution. So she's supposed to give him three bits, x1, x4, and x7. Okay? So she's trying to convince him, or both of them are trying to convince him that there's more than 99% of these equations that are solvable. So she gives him this equation. And now what he does is he turns to the other prover and asks her to give him the value of a random variable of one of these. So either x1 or x4 or x7, he chooses one at random and asks her for the value. And what he checks to see is that the value he got from her is consistent with the value he got from the first prover for this equation. What's the point? The point being is this. The second prover, she has no idea, the blue one, she has no idea which equation he asked from the first one. Okay. So when he's asking her for a variable, it could be the x1 that appeared here, but it could be for the x1 that appeared here. It's the same x1, but it could be that he's, or this one, right? It could be that either of these three, he got solutions for them from the first one. So if she's cheating, what's her best strategy for answering x1? What one is able to prove that essentially there is no good strategy. So unless she answers, if they are cheating, if less than 51% of the equations are solvable, there's very good chance that what she will answer will be inconsistent with the first prover answered, and he will reject. But if more than 99% of the equations are solvable, then the honest strategy, which is just there is an assignment to x1 to xn, you just answer according to that, will be such that it will satisfy both what the provers are expecting to see. Again, this gives you a taste that somehow we are doing it very differently than just solving all the equations. We're sort of selecting a random equation and then checking from somewhere else whether there's a consistency between that solution of this equation and single variable assignments. This is the type of tricks that are used to show essentially that you can take very complex proofs, okay, in the sense of long proofs, and convert them to very short proofs. And that takes me back, so I'm jumping here, to the cloud. All right, so back to the cloud, okay, back to the applications. We did a very, very long detour. Talked about zero knowledge proofs, about interactive proofs, about reducing how much you have to read from a proof, and what does that have to do back to our applications? So back in the cloud, let's think about this question of correctness. So the cloud is really powerful, it has lots of powerful programs, and I'd like to use it. I have my miserable device, I send my input to the cloud, and I want to get the results. Right? How do I know that what I get back is really the result of running the program on my data? Well, one thing I could do is redo it. Obviously, it makes no sense. The only reason I went to the cloud is because I had no power to do it myself. So we say, let's trust but check. I think it's some quote from Reagan or something. And the idea is what we want the cloud from now to do is to compute and then prove results. So the paradigm is instead of just computing, it's computing and proving. So to every answer, there will be attached a proof. But what kind of proof? If it was the old classical kind of proof, essentially, they would require going through all steps of the computation. So we want a new kind of proof, which is extremely fast to verify. So we want very efficient to verify. So how about an interactive proof? Where we ask a few more questions, and at the end, we are convinced with high probability that the computation was done correctly, and yet we're able to verify very quickly. And using a lot of these sort of ideas that I claimed in the previous slides, you can actually, at the end, turn it so that there's little interaction, and the size of the messages that I'm sending is short. And yet, I can verify quickly the correctness of the claims of the cloud. So, too much here, but there's literature for the last, I don't know, 20 years at this point, or 25 years, of how you can use machinery in the context of cloud computing. So in a sense, the way the history works here is that there's theoretical results, and they sort of improve more and more, bigger class of problems that you can work on with shorter, more efficient proofs, and then people build systems. So it's actually an interesting place in theory where probably the most theoretical results that you could think of from complexity theory have had an implementation project go with them, because people realize that, you know, if we're talking about clouds and so forth, in some sense there's a test, the test is in the pudding, or how do you call that? In English you say that, but I don't know if there's a Hebrew phrase. To say that, you know, we have this amazing theory result, we're saying it's going to be applicable to cloud computing, is that true? There are actually all these implementation, including some things that are done here in the Technion in Tel Aviv, trying to come, essentially extract the heart of this theory and translate it into practice. Now, in the 10 minutes that I have, let's go to the next problem, and that is, forget about control, what about privacy? So as I said before, one of the things that we need to do is to compute on very sensitive data, like my medical records, my financial records, and so forth. But I don't want the cloud to know my data. So how do we address that? How do we get privacy? Encryption is the obvious answer. So I'm not going to give my data, I'm going to give my encrypted data. But once I give my encrypted data, how do I expect the cloud to run programs on my encrypted data? Right? I mean, I want to get both privacy and utility. And as soon as I encrypt it, there's no utility. Because really, traditional encryption is an all or nothing. So either you let the cloud have a decryption key, and then they can decrypt and compute, or they have nothing. So encryption is not a solution, at least not traditional encryption. And what has happened is that there are new types of encryption being developed in the last, I don't know, 8 years or so, where besides encrypting the information, you can actually work with the encrypted form. Here are a few names, at least. Fully homomorphic encryption, which you may have heard of, proxy-free encryption, attribute-based encryption, functional-based encryption. Since I have probably 5 minutes, I'm going to give you just a taste, okay? Yes? So encryption, we understand. You put in a box, and you hide the key. If I gave you the key, you can decrypt and read the data. Now I want encryption that is more flexible. And here are various degrees of flexibility. Let me give you a slide or so on each one of them. Because that's, in fact, kind of the forefront of cryptography today, in addition to this obfuscation problem. OK, so first of all, fully homomorphic encryption is something that has made a lot of, has a lot of publicity, and rightfully so, with this paper by Gentry, who's a Stanford PhD. So for the PhD students in the crowd, I encourage you to follow his example. That's a good PhD thesis. So what he does is he comes up with an encryption scheme where, in a sense, when you not only send the encryption of the data, you also send something called an evaluation key along. What does an evaluation key enable to do? It enables you to essentially execute arbitrary programs on encrypted data without decrypting first. What does that mean? It enables you to compute the encryption of the results of running the program on the data. So this is not a decryption key. So it's not that you decrypt and then you compute, but somehow without decrypting, you are able to do computation on this to end up with that for any program. And that means that, again, the cloud is using its power, it's doing very intense computation, but the client, all he needs to do at the end is, in the beginning, to encrypt, and at the end, to decrypt, and he'll get the results. So it's gone through quite a bit of history since 2008. There have been huge developments. So it started with an assumption which was maybe less known and maybe less believable. By now, it has the same assumption as the best non-homomorphic scheme. So remember those equations that I had with the noise? So based on that kind of an assumption, you have a fully homomorphic scheme. There's variants of it which are multi-key, which means that many people can encrypt under different keys, okay, and yet this cloud can compute an aggregate or joint computation across the evaluation keys. Even though they're using different evaluation keys, at the end you'll have an encryption of a result on all the data from different encryptions. What's the key idea here? There's lots of key ideas, but in a nutshell, if I had to say one, let's look at this program. This program is very simple, right? It says if x3 is 0, stop. Otherwise, output x1 plus x2. So you can take such a program, or any program written in C or Java or whatever, and convert it to a Boolean circuit, where essentially the inputs are variables, and the intermediate operations are like plus and times mod 2. over GS2. So in particular, this program, it translates to that. So all programs can be written like that. Now suppose that you had somebody just gave you those X1, X2, X3, they just gave you encryptions of them, okay? You're at that cloud computer, you're getting encryptions. How are you gonna compute this? How are you gonna add, and then how are you gonna multiply and get the result? So in order to compute the program. The answer is if the encryption had an extra special property where you could essentially starting from encryption of X1, encryption of 2, get encryption of the sum, or encryption of X1, encryption of X2, get encryption of the product. If you did somehow key magic, this is an extra property, then no problem. You just perform this operation here, then you perform the product here, and you get the result. So what is that telling you? Is that all you need to do is to come up with an encryption scheme that which this is true. You're able to compute sums and products. It's not as simple as you think, but it's doable, and that's what Gentry showed. So he showed essentially how to do it with some very ingenious ideas where every time you do an operation, you introduce actually some noise into the computation. So you can, this is true with, there's some chance that it's false. There's some noise. And this is true, but there's even a bigger chance that it's false. And as every time you do an operation, it becomes sort of noisier and noisier, but still he showed a way to kind of do arbitrary number of operations by cleaning up the noise. In any case, the point is that in some sense, you start with an impossible question, and then you see with the use of mathematics, it actually is possible, because you've broken it down to a much simpler problem here. Now, there's been a lot of work on reducing this to practice. I think to begin with, people thought this was completely theoretical. But these days, they realize that if you tailor it to specific domains, specific problems, specific data sets, you can actually do this practice. So for example, you can use it for disease risk computation. You can identify patients with genetic disposition, let's say, to breast cancer, using homomorphic encryption. And the benefit here is that you are encrypting people's DNA sequences and still finding who has the risk. You can run machine learning classification on encrypted data. So these are actually projects out there that are using homomorphic encryption that have been defined in the last 8 years for real life problems. And I kind of emphasize that even though I'm a theoretician and I'm not supposed to talk about this maybe, because I think it is very important to realize that these methods have a chance to address this benefit versus risk paradigm. What else? So I mentioned this word proxy re-encryption. This is essentially telling you that you could take data, let's say encrypted under classical methods, like AES or RSA or whatever, and you can convert it to a homomorphic encryption scheme. So it encrypts data in a way that you can work on it. Okay? And this all can be done sort of by a server that doesn't know how to decrypt either one, but was given some information from both that enables it to do these translations. And this ability to do the translation, in a sense, if you think about it, it's like decrypting this and re-encrypting. But not by looking at keys, but in some other way, you can sort of do this magic translation. Another thing I mentioned was functional encryption, which is the last thing that I'm going to talk about, last two slides. What's functional encryption? So the idea here is, let's look at the cloud, and let's say it has a lot of encryption. Encryption of data one, data two, data three, and so on. And, you know, so far I was, the picture of the cloud, there was cloud on one hand, and there was a user on the other hand. Gave some data and got some result. But the truth is that if you are doing analysis of energy usage or traffic and so forth, there's no user to go back to and ask questions from. You're collecting data and you want to make informed decision based on the data, right? If all that data was encrypted, how are you going to do it? So the idea here is that there is for every program you want to run, whether it's analysis of energy or analysis of traffic, there's going to be which enables you, so if you give that key to Waze or to whoever doing your energy consumption analysis, using that key, they can run specific program on the data, but not other programs. So the fully homomorphic, right, computation was done and then it was still encrypted and they send it back to the user to decrypt. Here, the server can already find out the information themselves. But they can't find out everything, because then they would know your data. They can only find out how the result of running a program on the data for particular programs that you have allowed, because you've given a key for that program. So this is in really kind of a super ability. And a good question is, can it be done for all programs or for interesting programs? Does it mean that the encryption is very inefficient? Maybe it's much bigger than regular encryption. Can you maintain security if you release keys for lots of programs? So these are the kind of questions we work on. Essentially, all of these have positive answers under that hard problem that I showed with the equations. We don't know if we can release an unbounded number of keys under that assumption, but it's very intimately tied to the obfuscation question. I guess just to skip this, just to get you a sense why that's important to be able to do functional encryption well, look at an application. Let's say that the laboratory needs to know whether to develop a drug now. So they want to look at all the genetic information of people with a particular phenotype, let's say people who have diabetes or something, and see that if they have a particular gene present, then it's worth developing the drug, otherwise they don't. But do you want to give them your medical, your entire DNA? Not necessarily. So is it possible that you encrypt it and that they can still check for how many of these profiles have a particular gene present? You'd like to enable them to do so. So you'd like to enable them to do so without reading your particular information. Using a functional encryption, you can do that. What you do is you give them a key, a special key that enables them to run this algorithm and check whether the number of files where that gene is present exceeds a certain threshold or not. And so you just give them a key that is able to do that. One other example might be privacy and policing. So we know there are cameras everywhere. You know, that's one of the issues that people say, well, there are cameras everywhere, there's no privacy, forget it. Okay? But suppose the cameras were always producing encrypted pictures. Let's say cameras for cars would actually take pictures of encrypted license plates. Wouldn't it be nice if we could, then if we suspected a crime was done in a particular place where cars came in, if we could compare these license plates to a suspect database license plate and only decrypt if this matches. So again, this type of encryption enables you to do so. So it will give you a key that only allows you to decrypt if the license plate that's been encrypted is on the database. So it's, in some sense, it's only in special cases that you'll be able to decrypt. All right, you've been extremely patient and we started late and I'm done. So there's one takeaway vision that I guess I think is important to repeat, and that is that whatever physical intuition we have today, that there's no chance for privacy, really should not constrain what you expect that is possible from digital privacy for tomorrow. That if you use advanced cryptography methods, or what I call the magic of cryptography, you can go a long way to benefit from big data, remote computing, while maintaining this basic right to be left alone. And it's a question of how you define exactly what you want to do and whether you use the right techniques in order to achieve it. So I think that the key is to think of new representations of programs and data, and instead of talking about computing, talk about crypto computing. Thank you.